we're going to tackle two chapters. They're kind of long, but we'll go ahead and get into them anyway. Wait a minute. Here we go. Chapter 4 and Chapter 5, States of Consciousness. And then Sensation and Perception is Chapter 5. So let's go ahead and get started with Chapter 4. Okay. That's a weird PowerPoint slide, but let's go ahead and get her done. Our lives involve regular dramatic changes in the degree to which we are aware of our surroundings and our internal states. While awake, we feel alert and aware of the many important things going on around us. Our experiences change dramatically while we are in deep sleep and once again when we are dreaming. Some people also experience altered states of consciousness through meditation, hypnosis, or alcohol and other drugs. All right, yeah, okay. Take a bite out of that ice cream cone. Consciousness describes our awareness of internal and external stimuli. Awareness of internal stimuli includes feeling pain, hunger, thirst, sleepiness, and being aware of our thoughts and emotions. Awareness of external stimuli includes experiences such as seeing the light from the sun, feeling the warmth of a room, and hearing the voice of a friend. We experience different states of consciousness and different levels of awareness on a regular basis. We might even describe consciousness as a continuum that ranges from full awareness to a deep sleep. Sleep is a state marked by relatively low levels of physical activity and reduced sensory awareness that is distinct from periods of rest that occur during wakefulness. Wakefulness is characterized by high levels of sensory awareness, thought, and behavior. Beyond being awake or asleep, there are many other states of consciousness among consciousness people experience. These include daydreaming, intoxication, of course, unconsciousness due to anesthesia. Often we are not completely aware of our surroundings, even when we are fully awake. Body temperature fluctuates cyclically over a 24-hour period. Alertness is associated with higher body temperatures and sleepiness with lower body temperatures. This pattern of temperature fluctuation, which repeats every day, is one example of a circadian rhythm. A circadian rhythm is a biological rhythm that takes place over a period of about 24 hours. Our sleep-wake cycle, which is linked to our environment's natural light-dark cycle, is perhaps the most obvious example of a circadian rhythm. But we also have daily fluctuations in heart rate, blood pressure, blood sugar, and body temperature. The hypothalamus is the main center of homeostasis. Homeostasis is the tendency to maintain a balance or optimal level within a biological system. The brain's clock mechanism is located in an area of the hypothalamus known as a suprachiasmatic nucleus, or the SCN. The axons of light-sensitive neurons in the retina provide information to the SCN based on the amount of light present, allowing this internal clock to be synchronized with the outside world. One important regulator of sleep-wake cycles is the hormone melatonin. The pineal gland, an endocrine structure located inside the brain that releases melatonin, is thought to be involved in the regulation of various biological rhythms and of the immune system during sleep. Melatonin release is stimulated by darkness and inhibited by light. And you can see the pineal gland. It's the red structure right there. That's the pineal gland. There are individual differences in our sleep-wake cycle. Some people would say that they're morning people, while others would consider themselves to be night owls. These individual differences in circadian patterns of activity are known as a person's chronotype. And research demonstrates that people have different sleep regulations. Sleep regulation refers to the brain's control of switching between sleep and wakefulness, as well as coordinating this cycle with the outside world. At times, a person's circadian clock gets out of synchrony with the external environment. One way that this happens involves traveling across multiple time zones. When we do this, we often experience jet lag. Jet lag is a collection of symptoms that results from the mismatch between our internal circadian cycles and our environment. These symptoms include fatigue, sluggishness, irritability, and insomnia. For example, a consistent difficulty in falling or staying asleep for at least 3 nights a week over a month's time. And I would say her circadian rhythm is kind of messed up. Rotating shift work refers to a work schedule that changes from early to late on a daily or weekly basis. In such instances, the individual schedule changes so frequently that it becomes difficult for a normal circadian rhythm to be maintained. This often results in sleeping problems, and it can lead to signs of depression and anxiety. These kinds of schedules are associated with persistent feelings of exhaustion and agitation that can make someone more prone to making mistakes on the job. They're finally working together. All right. When people have difficulty getting sleep due to their work or the demands of day-to-day life, they accumulate a sleep debt. A person with a sleep debt does not get sufficient sleep on a chronic basis. The consequences of sleep debt include decreased levels of alertness and mental efficiency. While there is tremendous variation in any given individual's sleep needs, the National Sleep Foundation cites research to estimate that newborns require the most sleep, between 12 and 18 hours a night, and that this amount declines to just 7 to 9 hours by the time we are adults. If you lie down to take a nap and fall asleep very easily, chances are you may have sleep debt. Lack of sleep can result in decreased mental alertness and cognitive function. Sleep deprivation often results in depression-like symptoms. These effects can occur as a function of accumulated sleep debt or in response to more acute periods of sleep deprivation. Sleep deprivation is associated with obesity, increased blood pressure, increased levels of stress hormones, and reduced immune functioning. Research shows that the most severe effects of sleep deprivation occur when a person stays awake for more than 24 hours following repeated nights with fewer than 4 hours in bed. Irritability, distractibility, and impairments in cognitive and moral judgment can occur with fewer than 4 hours of sleep. If someone stays awake for 48 consecutive hours, they could start to hallucinate. When we are very young, we spend up to 16 hours a day sleeping. By the time we are 65 years old, we average fewer than 7 hours of sleep per day. We spend approximately one-third of our lives sleeping. Given the average life expectancy for U.S. citizens falls between 73 and 79 years old, we can expect to spend approximately 25 years of our lives sleeping. A definition of sleep must include mention of the interplay of the circadian and homeostatic mechanisms that regulate sleep. Homeostatic regulation of sleep is evidenced by sleep rebound following sleep deprivation. Sleep rebound refers to the fact that a sleep-deprived individual will fall asleep more quickly during subsequent opportunities for sleep. Sleep-wake cycles seem to be controlled by multiple brain areas acting in conjunction with one another. Some of these areas include the thalamus, the hypothalamus, and the pons. The hypothalamus contains the SCN, the biological clock of the body, in addition to other nuclei that, in conjunction with the thalamus, regulates slow-wave sleep. The pons is important for regulating rapid eye movement sleep, and that's also known as REM. Sleep is also associated with the secretion and regulation of a number of hormones from several endocrine glands, including melatonin, follicle-stimulating hormone, luteinizing hormone, and growth hormone. The pineal gland releases melatonin during sleep. Melatonin is thought to be involved in the regulation of various biological rhythms and the immune system. During sleep, the pituitary gland secretes both FSH and LH, which are important in regulating the reproductive system. The pituitary gland also secretes growth hormone during sleep, which plays a role in physical growth and maturation as well as other metabolic processes. One popular hypothesis of sleep incorporates the perspective of evolutionary psychology. One hypothesis from this perspective might argue that sleep is essential to restore resources that are expended during the day. People sleep at night to reduce their energy expenditures. Another evolutionary hypothesis of sleep holds that our sleep patterns evolved as an adaptive response to predatory risks, which increase in darkness. Thus, we sleep in safe areas to reduce the chance of harm. Another theory regarding why we sleep involves sleep's importance for cognitive function and memory formation. We know sleep deprivation results in disruptions in cognitive and memory deficits, leading to impairments in our abilities to maintain attention, make decisions, and recall long-term memories. These impairments become more severe as the amount of sleep deprivation increases. Slow-wave sleep after learning a new task can improve resultant performance on that task and seems essential for effective memory formation. Getting the optimal amount of sleep has also been associated with other cognitive benefits. Research indicates that included among these possible benefits are increased capacities for creative thinking, language, learning, and inferential judgments. It is possible that even the processing of emotional information is influenced by certain aspects of sleep. Sleep is composed of several different stages that can be differentiated from one another by the patterns of brainwave activity that occur during each stage. These changes in brainwave activity can be visualized using EEG and are distinguished from one another by both the frequency and amplitude of brainwaves. When we are fully awake and alert, this may not be when you are sitting through a boring lecture. Our brains have a very complex and active pattern called beta waves. As we start to get drowsy, are very relaxed but not quite asleep, our brains begin emitting a slower, less involved pattern called alpha waves. As we start dipping into the first stages of sleep, when your head drops down on your hand during a lecture, your brain pattern is slowing even more and in less complex pattern known as theta waves. As we dip into our deepest sleep, our brain patterns slow down markedly and the complexity is almost gone. These waves are known as delta waves. According to research done with soldiers suffering from post-traumatic stress disorder from the war, dreams during this deepest sleep are realistic and deal with what you are thinking about. After individuals have been in delta wave sleep for about 30 minutes, the individual's brain wave suddenly accelerates until the brain waves are similar to the brain waves when they are wide awake. But they're not. They're still asleep. During this stage, the individuals tend to do most of their dreaming, and they tend to be quite vivid with fairly extreme imagery. This stage is especially marked with rapid movements of the eyeball underneath the lids. Hence, the stage is referred to as REM, or rapid eye movement. Oddly, during REM, only the eyeball is able to move. The rest of the body is paralyzed. If people are deprived of REM sleep and then allowed to sleep without disturbance, they will spend more time in REM sleep in what would appear to be an effort to recoup the lost time in REM. This is known as the REM rebound, and it suggests that REM sleep is also homeostatically regulated. Aside from the role that REM sleep may play in processes related to learning and memory, REM sleep may also be involved in emotional processing and regulation. In such instances, REM rebound may actually represent an adaptive response to stress in non-depressed individuals by suppressing the emotional salience of aversive events that occurred in wakefulness. Dreams and their associated meanings vary across different cultures and periods of time. By the late 19th century, Austrian psychiatrist Sigmund Freud had become convinced that dreams represented an opportunity to gain access to the unconscious. By analyzing dreams, Freud thought people could increase self-awareness and gain valuable insight to help them deal with the problems they faced in their lives. Freud made distinctions between the manifest content and the latent content of dreams. Manifest content is the actual content or storyline of a dream. Latent content, on the other hand, refers to the hidden meaning of a dream. For instance, if a woman dreams about being chased by a snake, Freud might have argued that this represents the woman's fear of sexual intimacy, with the snake serving as a symbol of a man's penis. And I, jiminy Christmas, that's, ooh, boy, that's a good catch. that's a cobra, isn't it? Anyway, she sure got it. Throw it away. There you go. The 20th century Swiss psychiatrist Carl Jung believed that dreams allowed us to tap into the collective unconscious. The collective unconscious, as described by Jung, is a theoretical repository of information he believed to be shared by everyone. According to Jung, certain symbols in dreams reflected universal archetypes with meanings that are similar for all people, regardless of culture or location. The sleep and dreaming researcher, Rosalind Cartwright, believes that dreams simply reflect life events that are important to the dreamer. Unlike Freud and Jung, Cartwright's ideas about dreaming have found empirical support. In other words, researchers have discovered that she may be correct. For example, she and her colleagues published a study in which women going through divorce were asked several times over a five-month period to report the degree to which their former spouses were in their minds. These same women were awakened during REM sleep in order to provide the detailed account of the dream content. There was a significant positive correlation between the degree of which women thought about their former spouses during waking hours and the number of times their former spouses appeared as characters in their dreams. And this is research done by Cartwright and her colleagues in 2006. Alan Hobson, a neuroscientist, has developed the activation synthesis theory of dreaming. The evolving theory sees dreams as a result of our brain attempting to make sense of or synthesize the neural activity or activation that was happening during REM sleep. Hobson in 2009 has suggested that dreaming may represent a state of proto-consciousness. In other words, dreaming involves constructing a virtual reality in our heads that we might use to help us during wakefulness. Hobson cites research on lucid dreams as an opportunity to better understand dreaming in general. Lucid dreams are dreams in which certain aspects of wakefulness are maintained during a dream state. In a lucid dream, a person becomes aware of the fact that they are dreaming, and as such, they can control the dream's content. And this is according to research done by LaBerge in 1990. Many people experience disturbances in their sleep at some point in their lives. Depending on the population and sleep disorder being studied, between 30% and 50% of the population suffers from a sleep disorder at some point in their lives. Insomnia is a consistent difficulty in falling or staying asleep and is the most common of the sleep disorders. Individuals with insomnia often experience long delays between the times that they go to bed and actually fall asleep. These individuals may wake up several times during the night only to find that they have difficulty getting back to sleep. One of the criteria for insomnia involves experiencing these symptoms for at least 3 nights a week for at least 1 month's time, and that's according to Roth in 2007. It is not uncommon for people suffering from insomnia to experience increased levels of anxiety about their inability to fall asleep. This becomes a self-perpetuating cycle because increased anxiety leads to increased arousal, and higher levels of arousal make the prospect of falling asleep even more unlikely. Chronic insomnia is almost always associated with feeling overtired and may be associated with symptoms of depression. There may be many factors that contribute to insomnia, including age, drug use, exercise, mental status, and bedtime routines. Not surprisingly, insomnia treatment may take one of several different approaches. People who suffer from insomnia might limit their use of stimulant drugs, such as caffeine, or increase their amount of physical exercise during the day. Some people might turn to over-the-counter or prescribed sleep medications to help them sleep, but this should be done sparingly because many sleep medications result in dependence and alter the nature of the sleep cycle, and they can increase insomnia over time. Those who continue to have insomnia, particularly if it affects their quality of life, should seek professional treatment. Cognitive behavioral therapy has been demonstrated to be quite effective in treating insomnia. Cognitive behavioral therapy is a type of psychotherapy that focuses on cognitive processes and problem behaviors. The treatment of insomnia likely would include stress management techniques and changes in problematic behaviors that could contribute to insomnia, such as spending more waking time in bed. A parasomnia is one of a group of sleep disorders in which unwanted disruptive motor activity and or experiences during sleep play a role. Parasomnias can occur in either REM or non-REM phases of sleep. Sleepwalking, restless leg syndrome, and night terrors are three examples of parasomnias. In sleepwalking or somnambulism, the sleeper engages in relatively complex behaviors ranging from wandering about to driving an automobile. During periods of sleepwalking, sleepers often have their eyes open, but they are not responsive to attempts to communicate with them. Sleepwalking most often occurs during slow wave sleep, but it can occur at any time during a sleep period in some affected individuals. And this is a lady who is sleepwalking. Ooh, she turned around and circled. REM sleep behavior disorder, RBD, occurs when the muscle paralysis associated with the REM sleep phase does not occur. Individuals who suffer from RBD have high levels of physical activity during REM sleep, especially during disturbing dreams. These behaviors vary widely, but they can include kicking, punching, scratching, yelling, and behaving like an animal that has been frightened or attacked. People who suffer from this disorder can injure themselves or their sleeping partners when engaging in these behaviors. These types of behaviors ultimately disrupt sleep, although affected individuals have no memories that these behaviors have occurred. RBD is associated with a number of neurodegenerative diseases, such as Parkinson's disease. In fact, this relationship is so robust that some view the presence of RBD as a potential aid in the diagnosis and treatment of a number of neurodegenerative diseases. Clonazepam, an anti-anxiety medication with sedative properties, is most often used to treat RBD. It is administered alone or in conjunction with doses of melatonin, the hormone secreted by the pineal gland. As part of treatment, the sleeping environment is often modified to make it a safer place for those suffering from RBD. A person with restless leg syndrome has uncomfortable sensations in the legs during periods of inactivity and when trying to fall asleep. This discomfort is relieved by deliberately moving the legs, which, not surprisingly, contributes to difficulty in falling or staying asleep. Restless leg syndrome is quite common and has been associated with a number of other medical diagnoses, such as chronic kidney disease and diabetes. There are a variety of drugs that treat restless leg syndrome: benzodiazepines, opiates, and anticonvulsants. Night terrors result in a sense of panic in the sufferer and are often accompanied by screams and attempts to escape from the immediate environment. Although individuals suffering from night terrors appear to be awake, they generally have no memories of the events that occurred, and attempts to console them are ineffective. Typically, individuals suffering from night terrors will fall back asleep again within a short time. Night terrors apparently occur during the non-REM phase of sleep. Generally, treatment for night terrors is unnecessary. Sleep apnea is defined by episodes during which the sleeper's breathing stops. These episodes can last 10 to 20 seconds or longer, and often are associated with brief periods of arousal. While individuals suffering from sleep apnea may not be aware of these repeated disruptions in sleep, they do experience increased levels of fatigue. Many individuals diagnosed with sleep apnea first seek treatment because their sleep partners indicate that they snore loudly and or stop breathing for extended periods of time while sleeping. Sleep apnea is much more common in overweight people and is often associated with loud snoring. Surprisingly, sleep apnea may exacerbate cardiovascular disease. While sleep apnea is less common in thin people, anyone, regardless of their weight, who snores loudly or gasps for air while sleeping should be checked for sleep apnea. There are two types of sleep apnea: obstructive sleep apnea and central sleep apnea. Obstructive sleep apnea occurs when an individual's airway becomes blocked during sleep and the air is prevented from entering the lungs. In central sleep apnea, disruption in signals sent from the brain that regulate breathing cause periods of interrupted breathing. One of the most common treatments for sleep apnea involves the use of a special device during sleep. The continuous positive airway pressure, or CPAP device, includes a mask that fits over the sleeper's nose and mouth, which is connected to a pump that pumps air into the person's airways, forcing them to remain open. And my wife has sleep apnea, and she has a CPAP machine that she uses every night. Otherwise, she might have more serious problems. In sudden infant death syndrome, or SIDS, an infant stops breathing during sleep and dies. Infants younger than 12 months appear to be at the highest risk for SIDS, and boys have a greater risk than girls. A number of risk factors have been associated with SIDS, including premature birth, smoking within the home, and hyperthermia. There may also be differences in both brain structure and function in infants that die from SIDS. There are a number of recommendations to parents to protect their children. Research suggests that infants should be placed on their backs when they are put down to sleep. Their cribs should not contain any items which pose suffocation threats, such as blankets, pillows, or padded crib bumpers, cushions that cover the bars of the crib. Infants should not have caps placed on their heads when put down to sleep in order to prevent overheating. People in the child's household should abstain from smoking in the home. A person with narcolepsy cannot resist falling asleep at inopportune times. These sleep episodes are often associated with cataplexy, which is a lack of muscle tone or muscle weakness, and in some cases involves complete paralysis of the voluntary muscles. This is similar to the kind of paralysis experienced by healthy individuals during REM sleep. Narcoleptic episodes take on other features of REM sleep. Around one-third of individuals diagnosed with narcolepsy experience vivid, dreamlike hallucinations during narcoleptic attacks. Surprisingly, narcoleptic episodes are often triggered by states of heightened arousal or stress. The typical episode can last for a minute or two to a half an hour. Once awakened from a narcoleptic attack, people report that they feel refreshed. Obviously, regular narcoleptic episodes could interfere with the ability to perform one's job or complete schoolwork, and in some situations, narcolepsy can result in significant harm and injury. And this is actually a narcoleptic episode for this little boy. He's actually dropping into a narcoleptic episode right there. There's a tremendous amount of variability among sufferers, both in terms of how symptoms of narcolepsy manifest and the effectiveness of currently available treatment options. This is illustrated by a case study of a 50-year-old woman who sought help for the excessive sleepiness during normal waking hours that she had experienced for several years. She indicated that she had fallen asleep at inappropriate or dangerous times, including while eating, while socializing with friends, and while driving her car. During periods of emotional arousal, the woman complained that she felt some weakness and in the right side of her body. And I had a friend when I was in service who was narcoleptic. We discovered it because every time we were medics, and every time we had an emergency in the emergency room, he would sit down and fall asleep. As weird as that seems, it took like four or five times before anybody said anything. They thought he was being a Goldberg, and he wasn't. He was narcoleptic. Although she did not experience any dreamlike hallucinations, she was diagnosed with narcolepsy as a result of sleep testing. In her case, her cataplexy was confined to the right side of her body, which was quite unusual. Early attempts to treat her condition with a stimulant drug alone were unsuccessful. However, when a stimulant drug was used in conjunction with a popular antidepressant, her condition improved dramatically. The fifth edition of the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Illness, Mental Disorders, fifth edition, DSM-5, is used by clinicians to diagnose individuals suffering from various psychological disorders. Drug use disorders or addictive disorders, and the criteria for specific substance use disorders are described in DSM-5. A person who has a substance use disorder often uses more of the substance than they originally intended to and continues to use the substance despite experiencing significant adverse consequences. In individuals diagnosed with a substance use disorder, there is a compulsive pattern of drug use that is often associated with both physical and psychological dependence. Physical dependence involves changes in normal bodily functions. The user will experience withdrawal from the drug upon cessation of use. In contrast, a person who has psychological dependence has an emotional rather than a physical need for the drug and may use the drug to relieve psychological distress. Tolerance is linked to physiological dependence, and it occurs when a person requires more and more drug to achieve effects previously experienced at lower doses. Tolerance can cause the user to increase the amount of the drug used to a dangerous level, even to the point of overdose and death. Drug withdrawal includes a variety of negative symptoms experienced when drug use is discontinued. These symptoms usually are opposite of the effects of the drug. Withdrawal from sedative drugs often produces unpleasant arousal and agitation. In addition to withdrawal, many individuals who are diagnosed with substance use disorders will also develop tolerance to these substances. Cocaine amphetamines, including some ADHD medications such as Adderall, methamphetamines, MDMA, ecstasy, or Molly, increase your heart rate, blood pressure, body temperature. When used, increased alertness, mild euphoria, decreased appetite in low doses. High doses increase agitation, paranoia. They can cause hallucinations. Some can cause heightened sensitivity to physical stimuli. High doses of MDMA can cause brain toxicity and death. Alcohol barbiturates such as sucralbitol, phenobarbital, benzodiazepines such as Xanax. These are the sedative hypnotic depressants. They cause decreased heart rate and blood pressure. Low doses increase relaxation, decrease inhibitions. High doses can induce sleep, cause motor disturbance, memory loss, decreased respiratory function, and death. The opiates, opium, heroin, fentanyl, morphine, oxycodone, Vicodin, methadone, and other prescription pain relievers. They cause decreased pain, pupil dilation, decreased gut motility, decreased respiratory function. They result in pain relief, euphoria, and sleepiness. High doses can cause death due to respiratory depression. One of the problems, they slow everything down in your body, and one of the things they slow down is your digestion. So constipation is very common with people that take opiates. Marijuana, the hallucinogens include marijuana, LSD, mescaline, DMT, dissociative anesthetics, including ketamine and PCP. Causes increased heart rate and blood pressure that may dissipate over time. It results in mild to intense perceptual changes with high variability in effects based on strain, method of ingestion, and individual differences. One of the most widely used drugs in the United States is a legal drug, alcohol. It is a legal drug. For many cultural groups, the drinking of alcohol is not only normal, but not drinking is abnormal. Many Europeans, people who still live in Europe, consider drinking necessary for adulthood. Not to drink is rude. I was playing in a soccer game in Metz, France, against the Mets firemen. And we played the game, and afterwards, they wanted to toast me because I played such a good game. So we came off the field, and I don't drink. So, and I tried to tell them that, but they just didn't register with them. And so we just about got into a fight because I wouldn't toast them back. That was the problem. And so we had to leave really fast to keep from getting into a fist fight over drinking. About 50% of the United States adult population drinks at least occasionally, with between 5% and 10% qualifying as alcoholics. And I obviously do not. I am an abstainer. In low doses, alcohol actually acts as a stimulant and is, in fact, used as a stimulant by some individuals with circulatory problems. I had a track coach when I was in college who had to drink a shot of whiskey in the morning just to get his circulation going. But into the second beer, depending on size, tolerance, and gender, the alcohol begins to act as a depressant on portions of the brain. In large enough doses, 0.5%, the cerebellum might become anesthetized and the individual's body will lose its ability to breathe. But all this depends on the size, tolerance level, and gender of the individual. Larger people with less fat tend to metabolize alcohol faster and dilute the alcohol in their larger circulatory system, and hence larger volume of blood. Women tend to be smaller than men with greater fat stores. They also have less alcohol dehydrogenase in their stomachs to break down the alcohol. Women tend to get drunk faster than men. Alcohol is a substance that the body identifies as a poison. The alcohol that is not metabolized by a digestive tract enters the blood and is removed by the liver. Those who drink to excess frequently are forcing their livers to handle poisons on a frequent basis. Cells in the liver may die in this process. Too much death will cause a condition where fat has replaced the dead cells, a condition known as cirrhosis. Besides being a poison to the liver, alcohol tends to deplete the B vitamin thiamine, also known as B1, in the brain, causing a condition known as Korsakoff syndrome, where the individual acts erratically and suffers from frequent hallucinations. And maybe, yeah, there we go.
Beer, 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 I'm going for a beer. Beer, 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 I'm gonna drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, 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 I'm going for a beer. Beer, 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 I'm gonna drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, 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 I'm going for a beer. Beer, 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 I'm gonna drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, 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 I'm going for a beer. Beer, 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 I'm gonna drink some beer. I like drinking beer. Lovely, lovely beer. Beer, 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 I'm going for a beer. Beer, 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 I'm gonna drink some beer.
Alright. Okay, well, that's what it looks like to be drunk. Anyway. Amphetamines are stimulants that increase the activity of the nervous system. Oddly, amphetamine usage became quite common during World War II, as both the United States and German armies used it extensively to carry on the war on an around-the-clock basis. The Germans developed a method of making methamphetamine right behind the lines to supply their soldiers. This method is still being used today by drug makers who use the Nazi method to make the drug. The most frequently prescribed methamphetamine today is given to children as young as 2 years old. The amphetamines Adderall and Ritalin are used to treat attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. A substance found in tobacco, nicotine, has fairly addictive properties. Cigarette producers have been raising nicotine levels in cigarettes for years by including illegal blends. As many as 40% of the adult U.S. population smoked in the 1960s. Today, the numbers are the same, but the percentages have decreased to 25%. 420,000 people die from the effects of nicotine every year. Only about 15% of smokers are able to kick the habit in any given year. Hypnosis is a state of extreme self-focus, an attention in which minimal attention is given to external stimuli. In the therapeutic setting, a clinician may use relaxation and suggestion in an attempt to alter the thoughts and perceptions of a patient. Hypnosis has also been used to draw out information believed to be buried deeply in someone's memory. For individuals who are especially open to the power of suggestion, hypnosis can prove to be a very effective technique, and brain imaging studies have demonstrated that hypnotic states are associated with global changes in brain functioning. How exactly does a hypnotist bring a participant to a state of hypnosis? While there are variations, there are four parts that appear consistent in bringing people into the state of suggestibility associated with hypnosis. These components include the participant is guided to focus on one thing, such as a hypnotist's words or a ticking watch. The participant is made comfortable and is directed to be relaxed and sleepy. The participant is told to be open to the process of hypnosis, trust the hypnotist, and let go. The participant is encouraged to use his or her imagination. For individuals who are especially open to the power of suggestion, hypnosis can prove to be a very effective technique. And brain imaging studies have demonstrated that hypnotic states are associated with global changes in brain functioning. Meditation is the act of focusing on a single target, such as the breath or a repeated sound, to increase awareness of the moment. While hypnosis is generally achieved through the interaction of a therapist and the person being treated, an individual can perform meditation alone. Often, however, people wishing to learn to meditate receive some training and techniques to achieve a meditative state. Although there are a number of different techniques in use, the central feature of all meditation is clearing the mind in order to achieve a state of relaxed awareness and focus. Mindfulness meditation has recently become popular. In the variation of mindful meditation, the meditator's attention is focused on some internal process or an external object. And that is the end of chapter 4. So let's go ahead and jump into chapter 5. There we go. Another attractive PowerPoint slide. Sensation and perception. What does it mean to sense something? Sensory receptors are specialized neurons that respond to specific types of stimuli. When sensory information is detected by a sensory receptor, sensation has occurred. For example, light that enters the eye causes chemical changes in the cells that line the back of the eye. These cells relay messages in the form of an action potential to the central nervous system. The conversion from sensory stimulus energy to action potential is known as transduction. The weakest stimulus that can be detected by a sense is the sense's absolute threshold. Scientists can measure this level by starting the subject at easily detectable levels and reducing them until the subject can't detect the stimulus anymore. The closed chamber hearing test is done this way. It is possible for us to get messages that are presented below the threshold for conscious awareness. These are called subliminal messages. A stimulus reaches a physiological threshold when it is strong enough to excite sensory receptors and send nerve impulses to the brain. This is an absolute threshold. A message below the threshold is said to be subliminal. We receive it, but we are not consciously aware of it. Over the years, there has been a great deal of speculation about the use of subliminal messages in advertising, rock music, and self-help audio programs. Research evidence shows that in laboratory settings, people can process and respond to information outside of awareness. Now, there's a reason why I have this picture here, and I'll explain it to you in just a second. Each of us has different levels of absolute threshold. Many times it relies more on how much the senses have been used or how little they have been abused as to how acute they are. But even the individual will have different levels of perception at different times and under different circumstances. Okay, why do I have this picture here? Where was I working? Ashford. I was working at Ashford University, and they kept bugging me about, what did your wife look like? Well, this lady right here, she looks exactly like my first wife. Anyway, she looks just like my first wife. This one, not the other three. The one sitting on the table. Wait a minute. With her legs crossed. That looks like my first wife. Okay, not important. The mixture of mechanical stimulus and emotional perception is known as psychophysical. And so why did they want to see a picture of my first wife? She's the mother of my two children. I've been married two other times. So I've been married to my current wife for, wait a minute, what year is this? We got married in 1979, so we've been married for 44 years. Yeah, 44 years. June 12th is our anniversary. The mixture of mechanical stimulus and emotional perception is known as psychophysical. The minimal difference between two stimuli that can be perceived as different is known as the difference threshold. Through the research of Ernst Weber, difference thresholds for the various senses have been determined. These levels are known as Weber's constants. A candle from 30 miles on a clear, dark night. A ticking watch from 20 feet in a quiet room. Of course, clocks don't tick anymore. 1 teaspoon of sugar dissolved in 2 gallons of water. A drop of perfume in a small house. Right. Fly wing falling on a cheek from 0.4 inches. The process by which organisms become more sensitive to stimuli that are low in magnitude and less sensitive to stimuli that are our constant magnitude is called sensory adaptation. Becoming more sensitive to stimuli of low magnitude is called sensitization or positive adaptation. Eyes adjusting to the dark, a driver adjusting to the pressure required for brakes of a new car, ears adjusting to the pitch of a high-pitched speaking individual, an individual tasting milk and skim milk after drinking homogenized milk all their life. All of these are positive adaptations. On the other hand, we grow less sensitive to constant stimulation. This is called desensitization or negative adaptation. Being unable to smell bad odors after being around them for a while, not being able to hear the constant cacophony of crickets and night creatures in the summer, being able to tolerate a cast or bandage after it has been on for a while, losing the cloying sweet taste of a sweet drink after the first swallow, being able to see normally after a few seconds after stepping into the bright sunlight and seeing orange. While Weber's constants assumes that we all perceive things the same, the signal detection theory takes everything else into account to rationalize why we don't perceive things the same. Some factors that influence our perceptions include noise, interfering sounds, the age and the well-being of the individual, motivation, expectations, and learning. And this is known as inattentional blindness. Okay. And if you watch this, well, you're supposed to count the number of times people are passing the ball. Okay. But what actually happens in the middle of it is that a gorilla walks through, and most people don't see the gorilla. Inattentional blindness. Most people consider their eyesight their most important sense. They believe what they see, even though it may be countermanded by another sense. This is known as visual capture. Light is a wavelength of electromagnetic energy. Only a small portion of it stimulates the human eye. This is referred to as visible light and includes the colors of the rainbow. The length of its wavelength determines what color we see. The eye is our instrument to detect light. Light is allowed in through the transparent covering of the front of the eye, known as the cornea. And it's the purple thing right here. That's the cornea. The white portion of the eye is the tough protective tissue known as the sclera. The colored part of the eye is a muscle that regulates the size of the opening into the eye, and this is known as the iris. The opening in the eye is known as the pupil. After the light passes through the pupil, it strikes a transparent mass called the lens. The lens is attached to muscles, which make it thicker for seeing close and thinner for seeing far away. The lens job is to focus the light on the neuron bank at the back of the eye. The bank of photoreceptors at the back of the eye is called the retina. The retina is composed of two types of photoreceptors, 100 million rods that see black and white, and 5 million cones that detect color. So you have 105 million receptors in each eye, or 210 million. Only 10 million see color. 200 million see black and white. The retina also includes four transmitter cells that speed the sensations of the photoreceptors to the brain. Bipolar cells receive the stimuli from the rods and cones, which funnel the information through the amacrine and horizontal cells into the ganglion cells. The ganglion cells form the optic nerve, which transmits sight impulses into the brain. The horizontal and amacrine cells are inhibitory circuit neurons that prevent missed detection due to spontaneous multiple stimulation. The fovea is an area about in the middle of the visual field that is almost exclusively cones. As the retina spreads from the fovea, it is made up of more and more rods until the periphery near the lens is exclusively rods. Where the optic nerve feeds out of the eye, it is a tiny area that has no photoreceptors. This is known as the blind spot, and this is what a blind spot actually looks like. You don't see this because you see this. It is filled in by what is happening around it. Because you have no rods in the center of your vision, you can see weak white light at night if you don't look directly at it. Thus, you are more likely to detect weak light with your peripheral vision than with your direct vision. Research has shown that different receptors are geared to respond to different wavelengths and thus colors. There are three types of cones that respond to our visual spectrum: short wavelength cones to the dark colors on the ultraviolet end of the spectrum. They inhibit yellow. Middle wavelength cones cover the middle of the spectrum, primarily green. They inhibit red. And long wavelength cones respond to the colors in the ultraviolet portion of the spectrum, red and yellow, and they inhibit green. Rods, of course, detect light and inhibit the absence of light. With 210 million impulses coming in, the brain must create a picture. This it does an infinite number of times a second. Even the most rapidly changing picture is detectable by the human brain. Eyes slowly adapt to darkness, the cones in about 10 minutes and the rods in about 45 minutes. This is known as dark adaptation. The eyes adapt to bright light much more rapidly. And there you go. So this is trying to teach you that you see better off-center at night than you do looking directly at something. Through surveys, psychologists have determined that most people attribute psychological dimensions to colors. Blue and green are considered cool. Yellow and red are considered warm. There are some people who get crossover sensations from stimulation. They are called senescents. I'm sorry. They can hear colors and see colors in music. They also detect smells and colors, as weird as that may sound. The three primary colors are red, blue, and yellow. Whenever these three colors are pure, they have optimum saturation or pureness of color or brightness. A color's saturation can be lessened by adding it to another color, such as yellow plus blue equals green. Green is not as bright as either yellow or blue. When you put the primary colors together, you get binary or secondary colors. Blue plus red equals violet, red plus yellow equals orange, and blue plus yellow equals green. Sorry, I needed a drink. Tertiary colors are created when you mix a primary color with an adjoining secondary color. And there you go, all those pretty colors. One of the reasons that colors are usually arranged in a circle is so that you can put complementary colors across from each other. When mixing paints, complementary colors will always yield gray or dark gray. Thus, yellow's complementary color is violet, red's complementary color is green, blue's complementary color is orange. Each primary color has a secondary color as its complement. When you look at a specific color for an extended period of time, long enough to cause sensory fatigue, about 30 seconds, and then you look away at a white background, you will see the same image but in its complementary colors. And this is known as an after image. This is the after image of this. So if we look at this long enough and then look at a white surface, this is what we'll see. This is a famous after image of the American flag. So if we look at this, we look at this black spot, if we focus on that black spot for 30 seconds, we will get fatigue, we will get eye fatigue. And then if we look at a white surface, we will see the American flag. On the average, people can discriminate up to 150 different colors. Cross-culturally, the six major color groups are white, black, yellow, green, red, and blue. Individuals who see all the visible colors of the color spectrum are called trichromates. Individuals who are totally colorblind can only detect light and dark and see everything in shades of gray. They are called monochromates. This is quite rare, but I had a student when I was teaching down in Mississippi, and he was a monochromat, and he was in the Air Force, and the strange thing was that he fixed airplanes. So a lot of times when you're especially working on the electrical units, the color of the wire is really important. This guy, he came to work one day, he came to school actually after work, and he had on, this was right after Desert Storm, when everybody went to the Middle East, and they wore brown uniforms. So normally they wore fatigues. They wore the green camouflage. And his green camouflage and his brown camouflage, you couldn't tell the difference between the two. So one day he came to work with a green camouflage shirt on and a brown camouflage pants on. And of course, his first sergeant told him, "Look, let your wife pick out your clothes every day, okay?" Yeah, he couldn't tell the difference between the camouflage. So what they started doing, they started putting little black specks in the brown uniform. Before it was just like the green uniforms, and he couldn't tell the difference. But of course, you know, the number of people that are in the service who are monochromats it's not that common. But they started putting that in there for other reasons, so that you could tell the difference at night, Anyway, partial color blindness or being colorblind to one of the pairs of colors is fairly common. And strangely enough, this seems to be sex-linked because it affects more males than females. So if you ever see a guy and they think that their outfit goes together, it may not be his fault. He may be partially colorblind because it is sex-linked and it does have something to do with that area of the X chromosome. That isn't canceled out by the Y chromosome. Okay, we saw that last time. Okay, so now we're going to look at this and see if you can tell we'll see if you're colorblind. If you see a number here, then and you see the number 26, then you're not colorblind. If you see the number 12, then you're not colorblind. This is a number 3. Some people see an 8, but that's a 3. And that is not a number at all. Wait a minute. I have some more. This is number... And this one tells you if you are you are red-green colorblind. Because if you can see 70, then... or 29. There's two numbers here. There's 70 if you're red-green colorblind. And if you're not, then you can see the number 29. Okay, and this is 26, and this is 45. This is the only one that's tricky. And a couple more. This one is number 12. This one is number 5, and this is number 8. And if you see it as a number 3, then you've got a color blindness. This has no number in it, so... The human mind is constantly seeking understanding and conformity. So if you didn't see any of those numbers that I described, then you are colorblind and you probably need to, you've been dealing with it all your life, so I don't know. You probably don't need to do anything. Just stay away from picking colors out, I guess. If your kid wants you to color something and you have to pick out the green crayon, be careful. The human mind is constantly seeking understanding and conformity. When it can't find conformity and totality, it fills in the parts as best it can. When we do this, especially with visual stimuli, it is called closure. The need to make a whole lot of pieces follows laws established by Max Wertheimer, called the laws of perceptual organization. And if you can see the oval here, that's closure. If you look at this and you see a dog right there, a hunting dog, that's closure because that's just a bunch of spots and these are just a bunch of curved lines. So if you see it as a whole, then that's the way your brain is supposed to operate. If you don't see the dog, then your brain is not closing this picture. Okay, we have some more pictures. This is the picture of a bunny rabbit, and this is picture of a plane. And one more, this is a famous picture. This is a soccer team from the famous Ajax from Holland. It's a soccer team out of Amsterdam. And this is a picture of Ajax. There's 11 lines here, if you count them. Ajax. The law of figure ground perception states that we recognize objects easier when they are in a readily recognized and usual background. When a figure is in an unnatural background, the relationship is said to be ambiguous, and the perceptions tend to be unstable. So if you see a man with a long nose playing a saxophone here, that's one thing you can see. Or a woman, a silhouette of a face of a woman. And this is either two men or a vase. And this is either a duck. Rabbit. This is Batman. And this is Hawkman. Figure ground perception. Other laws of perception include proximity or nearness, which is the perceptual tendency to group together objects that are near to one another. Now, if you see all these men as being together, then possibly that's exactly what you're talking about. This is has to do with proximity. So if you look at all these circles and you go, well, that's six rows of seven circles, you know, that's known as proximity. You're putting all the circles together. You're assuming all these circles are supposed to go together. And you're assuming all these men are supposed to go together. Similarity is the tendency to group objects that are similar together. These are all African Americans sitting at a table. Are they together? And the answer is no, they're not. But because they're all African Americans and they're all sitting at the same table, the assumption may be that they're all supposed to be together. In the same way with this similarity, we have the gray circles, we have the yellow circles. If the assumption is that it's supposed to be that all the circles are supposed to go together, or if we're counting, well, there's four lines of gray circles and four lines of yellow circles. That's similar. That's what we're talking about, similarity. Continuity is a tendency to perceive groups of similar items as continuous and in a unit. And of course, if we see this as two sticks that are two straight sticks behind a stump, this may be what we're actually looking at, and we think it's two straight sticks. If you see circles with a square on it and then an X on top of the square, that's not actually what's here. We have four Pac-Men that are coming together, and the square doesn't exist. Or maybe it does. Continuity. Common fate is the tendency to perceive elements that move together as belonging together. And this is a picture of a Westminster dog show. They had this type of dog. I'm not sure what type of dog that is. Anyway, they went out to walk their dogs before they were supposed to take them in. But none of those guys were together. They weren't together at all. They just happened to be in a line. Same way with these bouncing balls. Because of our need to put things together and the different circumstances that these may occur in, we have two strategies as to how to put things together. If we are required to create an unknown entity from pieces, like an architect, an author, or a painter, this is known as bottom-up processing. If we know the end result, then it is easier for us to work using top-bottom processing. We know what the result's supposed to be, so we start with the idea of the finished product, and we break it down so that we can start at the right place and get it done. However, if you're an author, or you're an architect, or you're a painter, then you don't know what it's supposed to look like from the beginning. So you start putting things together without a knowledge of how the end product is supposed to look. This happens a lot to architects, because architects are told, well, we need a building and it needs to be this size. So you put something together and with the understanding that they're going to be changing the criteria as the process of building the building is going on. So you start out with, well, we're going to start with, you know, with this base. We need this much of a base, and then we will start putting things together. And then as the new criteria comes in, you have to continually be adjusting all of that. Depth perception is accomplished through the use of both monocular and binocular vision. Artists are wizards at using monocular cues to create the illusion of depth on a two-dimensional surface. Such techniques as perspective, clearness, interposition, shadows, and texture gradient give the observer cues as to depth. Perspective refers to the way like objects look smaller farther away. It also refers to the fact that parallel lines will converge as they recede in the distance. And of course, these are two cats that are exactly the same size. One is farther away than the other. And as we can see, these lines are converging the farther away they are. And the same thing here with the trees. The story is told of the pygmy chief who had lived all his life in the close confines of the rainforests of Zaire. On his first visit to the plains of the Serengeti, he saw a dangerous rhinoceros off in the distance. He referred to the animal as a horned rabbit and offered to take his small bow and arrow and procure it for dinner. Never having experienced anything from more than 10 or 15 feet away in the rainforest, his perspective was thrown off when he could suddenly see a half mile or more in the distance, and he thought the rhinoceros must be a rabbit. And that's what he saw. Looks like a rabbit to me. Well, maybe not. And there's another perspective. Okay, so is the giraffe, does the giraffe have a hold of the airplane wing? And the answer is no, the airplane's landing. And they happen to get the picture right there. And there we go. Another picture. The lady lost her head as she was exercising. Perspective also refers to the fact that's a mat. Working on the mat. Perspective also refers to the fact that the closer an object is, the more distinct its details. The farther away, the fuzzier the details. I mean, of course, as we look at this and we look at the walls, this is closer because we can see more detail. And as we move farther and farther back, a little less detail, and these walls are very indistinct. Another monocular cue is interposition. It is where one object is in front of another. It will obscure a part of the object. And of course, this is an interesting picture. He's acting like he's holding this this sign, but he's not. That's a sign that's across the street. And he's standing on the other side of the car. He's not standing up in the sunroof. And he's not standing on the moon. The way art used to work, you couldn't put anybody in front of Jesus, so and Mary. And so this is Mary and Jesus, and everybody has to be behind them, but you can, it's really hard to tell where they are, because Mary and Jesus have to be in front. Another monocular cue is shadowing. Shadowing is the situation where a non-transparent object will create shadows opposite the direction of the light. This will also give us cues about the three-dimensional shape. And there we go. Shadows. The last cue is texture gradient. The closer an object is, the more detailed the texture, and thus the rougher the appearance. And of course, these are rolls of hay. And as they get farther and farther away, they get less distinct. Same with sunflowers. As they get farther and farther away, they become less and less distinct. And these are bricks. And we see exactly the same thing. A motion cue to depth perception is motion parallax, or the phenomenon that objects that are closer to you move by more rapidly than objects that are farther away. And that is motion parallax. And that is motion parallax. And that's the famous Neuschwanstein. Now, this is really kind of an interesting perspective, because this is behind Neuschwanstein. I've been to Neuschwanstein. There are two castles there. And this one shows the smaller castle, which is where everybody lived. Neuschwanstein, nobody ever lived in. And the reason they didn't live in it was because they didn't have enough money to finish it. Okay, but they all lived in this castle right here. This is in Bavaria. And I've never really seen this perspective before because, like I said, this is behind it. Behind the castle. Normally you see it from the front. What were we talking about? Motion parallax? Yeah. Motion parallax. Binocular cues aid depth perception through two mechanisms, retinal disparity and convergence. Retinal disparity refers to the fact that as objects come closer to the face, each eye gets a different view of the same thing. These slightly different views tell the brain just how far away the object is. And this is an example of retinal disparity. Yeah. Seen by the left eye, seen by the right eye. Another binocular cue is convergence. As the object gets closer to the face, the two eyes try to stay on it. At some point, the eyes must start looking cross-eyed. This is accomplished through a great deal of muscular activity and thus tension. This information tells the brain that the object is close to the face. One's ability to perceive the same objects far away are smaller than they are when close is known as size constancy. This is an aspect of perspective. And of course, if we look at these two figures, if we measure these two figures, this one looks larger than this one, but they are actually the same size. And the same way with these humans. They're actually both the same size. And size constancy. His feet are really not that big. And they're really not about to be stepped on. And she's actually bigger than he is. I mean, he's actually bigger than she is. People retain the ability to perceive known colors despite the changing light. This is known as color constancy. In the same vein, people perceive brightness as the same, though light intensity may change it. This is known as brightness constancy. Objects seen from odd angles are still perceived as the proper shape because of shape constancy. And we know what a door looks like, and we know how big it probably is, even if it's partially open. And we know that that cat really does have legs, probably. She's just flying through the air. The stimulus to initiate the auditory system is a vibration that changes the airwaves by accelerating and changing molecules in the air, producing sound. Sound is produced as low as 20 cycles up to 20,000 cycles per second. We determine pitch by the number of cycles per second. These are measured in hertz. We determine loudness by the difference in the minimum and maximum air pressure created by the airwave. A large difference or amplitude and the louder the sound. The closer the minimum and maximum air pressure and the softer the noise. Loudness is measured in decibels. In music, the mixing of frequencies that sound good or harmonious together are called consonant. If they do not sound good together, they are called dissonant. Timbre is the mixture of frequencies coming from a musical instrument. If the instrument produces sound from more than one sounding area, it is said to have overtones, and that's what happens with a guitar. That's why when you pluck on an electric guitar, you get a really strange sound. But when you play an acoustic guitar, the sound is going into the guitar mass, and it's coming out the sound hole. And because of that, of course, you get a much richer sound. So when you play an electric guitar, because it doesn't have a sound hole, you get a very, very different sound. Pianos are kind of the same way. You're plucking the strings, but it's also going through a sounding board. And that's one of the reasons why a harpsichord and a piano sound very, very much different. And an organ. The instrument for hearing is the ear. It consists of three parts, the inner, middle, and outer ears. The observable portion of the skin cartilage arranged in dips and folds is called the pinna. And they used to, in the old days, they used to take prints of people's outer ear. And according to people, or according to the police, everybody's ear was different. And, of course, they use that instead of fingerprints, as strange as that may seem. The pinna catches sound waves and directs them into the external auditory canal, which leads to the middle ear. And that's the reason you have such big ears. or small ears, if you have small ears. So if you have small ears, do you hear as well as people with big ears? And the answer is probably not quite. And that's what a pinna really looks like. That's a hair. That's his pinna. The beginning of the middle ear is a small taut membrane or eardrum. This catches the sound wave and amplifies it. This amplification induces the three ossicles to vibrate. Ossicles means small bones. They are the hammer, the anvil, and the stirrup. The stirrup, in turn, vibrates against the beginning of the inner ear, another membrane, the oval window. The oval window is a membranous covering into a fluid-filled structure known as the cochlea. Cochlea is Latin for snail shell because that's exactly what it looks like. The cochlea contains three fluid-filled chambers, the vestibular, tympanic, and cochlear canals. They run like a three-chamber conduit through the cochlea. When the outer canal is stimulated by the vibration against the oval window, it forces the fluid into the other two canals. This movement of fluid stimulates the receptor cells, hair-like neurons that lay between the tectoral and basilar membranes. This is known as the organ of Corti. The hair receptors tie directly into the auditory nerve, which relays the stimulus to the brain. The brain uses a very similar, simple means to locate sound. The side that the sound is louder on is the side where the sound is coming from. This works unless the sound is straight ahead, behind, below, or above. In this case, individuals usually cock their head to one side to detect location. There are two theories as to how pitch is detected. The place theory alleges that pitch is determined by the place along the basilar membrane which vibrates the sound. The higher the pitch, the closer the response to the oval window. Low-pitch tones are responsive along the whole basilar window. This is why low-pitch tones are easier to hear than high-pitch tones. Frequency theory states that pitch depends on the stimulation of neural impulses that match the frequency of the sound waves. In other words, the hair cells in the organ of Corti vibrate at the same frequency as the sound waves, but only up to 1,000 Hz. There are three types of deafness. Conduction deafness occurs when there is damage to a portion of the middle ear. This malady short-circuits the conduction of sound waves through the middle ear. This type of problem can usually be helped by the use of a hearing aid. Sensory neural deafness comes from structural damage to some part of the inner ear, usually the receptor cells or the auditory nerve. Hearing aids for this type of deafness detect sounds at the problem pitch area and amplify it. Damage to the auditory nerve, however, is not treatable. Stimulation deafness is caused by the prolonged exposure to loud noises. Often these losses are just at the frequency of the loud noise, such as gunfire, but is untreatable. The area of the brain that detects smells is the... Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so we're talking about hearing. I have a hearing loss myself. It is because when I was in the service, I worked in a laboratory, and the laboratory had a centrifuge, and the centrifuge spun at a certain frequency, and that's where my hearing loss is. Unfortunately, it spun at a fairly high pitch, and because of that, I sometimes have difficulty understanding what women are saying because their voice is so high pitched. If they lower their voices, then I can understand what they're saying. As strange as that is. But I've had students that talked at such a high pitch that I couldn't hear what they were saying. The other problem that I have is has to do with music. So if the music is at a certain pitch, it doesn't sound good to me. And that's a higher pitch. Or some I listen to opera, and there are some sopranos that just don't sound good to me. Okay, the area of the brain that detects smells is the most primitive area of the brain. Research done with newborns shows that the baby can identify their mother by her smell, and that human detection of pheromones is quite acute, though rarely conscious. The odors that we detect are actually gaseous chemicals in molecular form. Smell takes place high in each nostril in the olfactory membrane. When the receptor neurons are triggered, the information is transferred immediately to the olfactory nerve, which transports it to the brain. The sense of smell follows the shortest route of all the senses. Some researchers have speculated that smell is accomplished much as neurotransmitters. Each has a specific receptor site on given neurons, but no one has proven this. Some people are unable to detect certain smells. This is known as anosmia, or smell blindness. Smell is one of the strongest memory recallers. Some biological psychologists feel that this is because it is tied to the limbic system, which is the seat of long-term memory. Most humans can detect over 10,000 different odors. The sense of taste is chemical in nature as well. Our taste receptors identify four basic taste qualities: sweet, sour, bitter, and salty. The fifth taste is umami. Umami has a nutty flavor and is found in fermented fish sauce. Umami is enhanced by MSG. And that's what a tongue looks like. Most flavors we detect are mixtures. The taste bud is the sensory receptor of the gustatory sense. Taste buds are stimulated by different chemicals. In order for something to be tasted, it must have the ability to break down in water and thus release chemicals to be detected. The taste buds in the mouth are known as chemoreceptors. The tongue is mapped as to the taste it can detect. The tip is the most sensitive to sweet and salty substances. The sides have mostly sour taste buds. The back and the soft palate and throat are mostly sensitive to bitter tastes. Taste bud receptor cells are located around the raised portion of the papillae and the indentations around the bumps. Each nerve has hair-like structures that lace the indentations. The hair-like projections on the taste bud serves as chemoreceptors. Each taste is processed in a different area of the brain. That is what makes taste the slowest of all the senses. Our skin holds neurons that detect touch, pressure, warmth, cold, and pain. Touch and pressure receptors are located around the roots of hair cells. Often, to get a feel for something, one must experience its texture by creating friction or rubbing your skin on the surface. And this is known as active touching. Our faces and fingers have the most numerous touch and pressure receptors and are therefore the most sensitive. Our temperature detection neurons are located right under the surface of the skin. There are two types, one's for warmth and one's for cold. Warm receptors will initiate the cooling mechanisms of the body, specifically sweating from eccrine sweat glands. Cold receptors will initiate the warming mechanisms, goosebumps, the standing up of hair follicles to trap a layer of air close to the skin, and shivering, which increases muscle activity and produces heat. Hot is detected when both warm and cold fire. Pain receptors will fire as well if there is any damage. Pain is a message to the brain that damage has been done to a certain part of the body. There are pain sensors that many parts of our body, but not all. Pain is initiated at the point of contact. For example, there are no pain sensors in your brain. The pain sensors release chemicals into the blood, which inform the brain of injury. Three of these chemicals are prostaglandin, bradykinin, and chemical P, and the P stands for peptide. These chemicals induce the brain to increase circulation to combat infection. This will, of course, cause swelling and redness in the area, especially if blood vessels are traumatized. It will also feel warm to the touch. The warmth helps keep bacteria from growing. The swelling will also serve to immobilize the area, which helps to protect the area. Analgesic drugs, such as aspirin and ibuprofen, work because they block prostaglandin production. They are also called anti-inflammatories for this reason. Localized pain can often be relieved for the short term by rubbing or scratching the area. This accomplishes what is called the gate theory. Only a limited amount of stimulation can be processed by the nervous system at a time. By flooding the brain with conflicting messages, you are blocking the pain messages from being received. This technique should not be used on broken bones, severe tissue damage, or where any bleeding or extensive swelling is present. When the brain detects pain, it pumps out its own painkiller, and these are known as endorphins. There's actually three of them. Endorphin, dynorphin, and enkephalin are the three painkillers that you produce yourself. Kinesthesis is a sense that informs us about the positions and motions of our various body parts. Our vestibular sense informs us of our body's position relative to gravity. This is accomplished through the detection of semicircular canals and the Eustachian tubes in the semicircular canal. People suffering from an inner ear infection have a hard time standing up because they don't know where their bodies are. And that is the end of the lecture. So that was a long one. I'll talk to you guys next week. I think we're tackling chapter 6 and 7, learning and thinking intelligence. Okay, I'll talk to you guys next week.